All right, come on in. It's good to see you here this morning. Let's all stand and join in singing about our hope in life and death. What is our hope?
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong, who holds our days within His hands. What comes apart from His command, and what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope streams eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess, Christ our hope in life and death.
He is our sure and steady anchor.
What truth can calm the troubled soul? God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trials, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore.
Good morning. Welcome to Gospel Hope. Do you believe what we just sang? You might be crazy. I mean, the world is on fire at this moment. And yet, we gather in a place like this and sing about hope, eternal life. We don't fear the grave, even though I know some of you are sick or have loved ones who are very, very ill. I mean, really, have we lost our minds? The answer is emphatically no. We've actually found our minds because we've found life in Jesus Christ. Oh, how much we hope you know Him, that you know the power and truth of the things that we were just singing. And if you are not sure about this God, the Savior, Jesus Christ, well, just kind of fasten your seatbelt because we're going to continue to sing more about Him. We're going to read scriptures that tell us all about Him and spend time in His Word unpacking some really significant truth today about the brevity of this life and the hope of an eternal life that never ends, a life yet to come. Welcome. I'm Danny Brooks, one of the pastors here at Gospel Hope. It's a privilege to serve this church week in and week out. Matt and Colleen are not with us today. Matt's actually doing a little supply preaching at a church here in the valley. We're thankful for the opportunity he has. Would you pray for him if you think of him through the morning? They miss being here. He sent our team a little text this morning. We want to keep Matt in our prayers. And there are others of us who serve in this capacity, and how thankful we are just to be a part of Gospel Hope. If you're a guest with us today, a special welcome to you. Josh Vinicky will say a little bit more in a moment about how we can become better acquainted, but we're delighted that you're here and hope that after the service we'll have an opportunity to meet. I see some people still looking for seats, so if you have an empty seat near you, welcome them in. If you can slide maybe to the outside of the sections or even just fill in one row so people don't have to climb over to the middle of a row, that's always helpful as well. But let's just be alert to those opportunities to serve one another. Well, let's turn our hearts to the Word of God, and I want to call your attention to 1 Peter 1, the hope that we were just singing of that sustains us through this life and we really believe will carry us into the life to come is spoken of all through the Scriptures. And listen to how Peter opens his letter written to the first century church. Many of the saints that he was writing to had lost everything, and they were exiled and living in foreign cities and foreign lands from what they had known and grew up in. But this is powerful. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him," listen to this, "though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls." Oh, dear brother or sister in the faith, keep believing to the end. We will see Jesus face to face. We will receive the promised inheritance that he has secured by his life and death. The best days are yet to come. Simeon Miller is going to lead us in prayer. You join him as we pray together in praise and thanksgiving to this great God.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, we just come before you this morning. We just want to thank you as we gather here together to worship you, not just for who you are, but also for what you have done for us through the work of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the cross. Lord, we thank you for who you are. And Lord, we just praise you for the hope that you have given those of us that have trusted in your Son. Lord, we pray, Father, that we would just open our hearts and minds to hear your word this morning. We pray that we pray that those among us that may not know you would not leave today without knowing you. And Lord, we just thank you for that. Lord, we just praise you for who you are, in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
The mountain.
the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my miracle.
Would you stand with me, please? If you could.
Changes God, thy compassions there.
Wow, great singing this morning. Just want to, for our guests, Danny alluded to this a little bit ago, but there's a card in the seat rack in front of you. One side is welcome, and that'll have the bulletin each week. You can sign up to have that automatically sent to you if you'd like. But guests, on the other side, there's a connect card. There's just a few short blanks there. If you'll help us out by just filling in that information, gives us a record of your visit. I'd just like to thank you for being here. You know, as Matt and Danny often say, we're not going to sell that information. We'll be careful with it. We'll send you one follow-up email that just tells you how you can get connected or gives you the opportunity to meet up with one of us if you'd like to learn a little bit more. You can also fill that out electronically by scanning that QR code if you prefer that. But if you'll take that card to the welcome table in the vestibule there right after the service, we have a small gift for you just to say thank you for being here. And if you filled out one of these cards recently and haven't received one of those gifts, make sure you grab one. It's a little mug with Gospel Hope Church, and I love it. Every time I pull that mug out of the cupboard, it's just a reminder to pray for one another. So we hope you will enjoy that gift. We have a few announcements, so if you'll throw that slide up, Wendy. Thanks. I'm not going to read all of these, but I do want to highlight a couple things. First thing being that first lineup, their nursery training tonight at the church at 4:30. If you have served in the nursery, if you'd like to serve in the nursery, we need you to be here. So please come. There will be dinner provided. There will be childcare provided. If you have any questions, you can talk to Daniel Kaminsky or Lizzie, Adam, or Diane that's seated there in the back. But please be here. Plan to be here at 4:30 for that nursery training. And let me just say to our nursery workers, we're very grateful for you. I mean, you really are serving young mothers and fathers so that they can be fully focused on worship of God in the service. And so it's very important work that you are doing, and we just want to thank you for that. A couple other things is there's a teen corn maze activity coming up Saturday. A little bit of a change there. I think originally we were going to meet at the corn maze, but meeting here at the church at 7, and then there will be transportation to the corn maze. So teens plan on being here for that. There's a cost of $10 for entry, but don't let the cost prohibit you from coming. We want you to come either way. Gospel Hope 101 next Sunday. So for those of you that maybe are new to Gospel Hope or you just haven't ever been to Gospel Hope 101 before, it's a meeting that we hold that just kind of goes over the core beliefs of Gospel Hope and what we're about here. And so whether you're planning on becoming members or not, we'd love for you to join us for that and just learn more about us. Attending Gospel Hope is a prerequisite to becoming a member, but attending doesn't mean that you have to become a member. Okay, so we'd love for you to join us for that. Couple opportunities to serve. Next, so you've noticed, I don't think Asa's here this morning, but Asa, as his Eagle Scout project, has helped coordinate building this fence around the property and the extension of the property. And so they've got a really good portion done. Well, they've finished their portion, and we still have one side left to do. So if you're able, next Saturday, Jonathan Griggs is going to be coordinating that and helping finish up the fence project. So anyone that's available, please come next Saturday. Meeting here at 8 a.m., but even if you can't be here right at 8, come when you can. I'm sure there'll still be some work to do. So please come and help serve in that way. And then, Wendy, if you go to the next slide, there's another opportunity, and I left my visual aid down here, so let me grab it. And that's this, Operation Christmas Child. Many of you may know about this. It's been around for some years. I remember doing this as a kid all growing up in the church of putting together these boxes. It's changed a little bit over the years. We used to have to collect shoe boxes. So we would go find shoe boxes from our closets. We'd go to the local stores and try to get boxes like this. and you fill them up with gifts for children from around the world. So you can put little toys in here, hygiene products, gospel tracts, books, like all kinds of things like that. And they get shipped all around the world to places and people that may not otherwise be getting a gift for Christmas and may not otherwise have an opportunity to learn about our Savior, Jesus Christ. And let me just tell you, we were talking about this recently, actually, and I don't know if Marion's here today, but I thought it was really neat as Marion was sharing some of his story with us in our growth group of growing up in an orphanage in Romania. He actually mentioned he used to get these boxes. And it was just amazing to me to just see that story of, like, you know, people you may never meet that might have received your box that you gave out. So we'd love for you to get involved in this. There's a bunch of boxes in the back lobby there. If we run out, we can get more. If you have any questions about what goes in the box or how it works, you can talk to Ala and Angelina. I don't remember your name, I'm sorry. But they're seated right here. But you could talk to any one of them, and they'll give you more information. But we do need these filled and put back in the church by like the second week of November. So that second Sunday in November, they need to be here. There's a little bit of a buffer there. So if you don't get it here by then, we'll need you to take it directly to one of the collection centers, though. So it saves you a trip if you'll just bring it to the church by that second Sunday in November. All right. Now as we turn our hearts towards giving, I'd like to read these verses from Lamentations. So this is Lamentations chapter 3, verses 21 through 26. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, great is your faithfulness. God, we don't deserve the kind of love and care that you give us. We don't deserve your grace. But yet you sent your Son to take our punishment for sin, to save our souls, that we could be heirs with Christ. And God, we believe that. We believe that you raised Jesus from the dead and that with the raising of Jesus, you can raise each one of us if we will just call unto him and believe in him. But yet, how foolish are we, God, that we can believe that? We can believe in the saving power of your love, but yet we often fail to believe the promises that you have for us each day. We fail to believe the grace and mercy that is there waiting for us new each and every morning. So God, forgive us where we fail you. Forgive us for our unbelief. We believe, God. Help our unbelief. Help us to just fully rest in the presence of your spirit here among us, God. Help us to rest in your promises. Help us to believe that you are working all things together for good to those that love you and are called according to your purpose. And God, in believing that, help us to recognize that everything that we have, every good thing, every good and perfect gift comes from you. Everything that we are, everything that we have is yours, and we are stewards of it. So help us to be good stewards. Help us not to waste the talents and time and treasure that you've given us. Help us to be your disciples and to make disciples. And God, now as we turn our hearts to giving to you, realizing that it's all yours, and we are just being faithful in giving what you have commanded us to. So God, we thank you and praise you for all that you are, all that you do. We thank you for your providence, your provision for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
This next song is a little bit lesser known to us here at Gospel Hope, and it speaks to the fact that God is above all. He is orchestrating things together here, like Josh was saying. He works all things together for good for those who love God, right? So if you know the song, go ahead and sing it out. If not, join in when you can. It's a good one. Let's sing it together.
Mm-hmm. The perfect wisdom of God revealed all the universe, all things created by His hands and held together at His command. He knows the mysteries of the seas, the secrets of the stars are His. He guides the planets on their way and turns the earth through another day. The matchless wisdom of His ways that mark the path of righteousness. His word a lamp unto His Spirit teaching and guiding me. And all the mystery of the cross, that God should suffer for the lost, so that the fool might shame the wise, and all the glory might go to Christ. Oh, grant me wisdom from above to pray for peace and cling to love, and teach me humbly to receive the Son and reign of Your sovereignty. Each strand of sorrow has a place within this tapestry of grace. So through the trials I choose to say, Your perfect will in Your perfect.
Each strand of sorrow.
Each strand of sorrow has a place within this tapestry of grace. So through the trials I choose to say, Your perfect will in Your perfect way.
Thanks for singing. Kids can be dismissed.
While the children head out and you open your Bibles to Ecclesiastes 7, I want to walk you through a couple of things, a couple of additional announcements and reminders. One, deacon recommendations we're opening a little window of time before the official nominations would be put together, and we typically work toward a December congregational vote to affirm the next set of deacons. We have some who will hit the end of two-year terms. There's a mandatory rolling off after four consecutive years of ministry that allows them to rest and renew. So we definitely have some open spaces. Sometimes people say, well, how many deacons are there? Well, we have eight right now. Josh Vinicky has moved into a role as elder, so he's no longer a deacon. A couple of other men, as I said, will be rolling off. We're not required to have eight deacons. It really is more a matter of who is biblically qualified and able to serve at this time. So as you think through recommendations, I would ask you to do that with your Bible open to 1 Timothy 3, verses 8 through 13. Tell us what the biblical qualifications for deacon are. A man might be more than that, but he can't be less than that, so keep that in mind. And as you read through that list of qualifications, it doesn't say anything about wildly successful in financial endeavors, you know, CEO of really impressive companies. It actually talks about a quality of heart and life, a spirit-filled character. So we want you to read through that and then pray through those recommendations, and you can submit those to any one of the elders. You could email them in, write it out on a piece of paper, hand it to us. I would ask you that you not just verbally nominate them, especially on a Sunday when we have so many things going on, because it's Some of the men would remember it. I can tell you, I likely will not. So put it in writing for us, please. We'll say more about that. Parents, we need your help. We know there is limited space here at Gospel Hope in the moment. We also know that your children have a ton of energy that needs to be released. We just need to work together in how that happens. So please guide your children. Many of you are proactively doing it. I just want to take a moment to give you a little reminder. Help your children understand that running through the building or across or over or under the chairs or between the legs of adults is not actually a loving and considerate thing to do. And I know some of you are like, oh, great, they're talking about us. Okay, I'll be honest, yes. But we're with you. I mean, again, you've heard me say many times, we have four kids. I remember some of those things. And, you know, they're the pastor's kids. And pastor's kids aren't supposed to do kid things, at least by the estimation of some. So we're going to work together. We're not upset with anybody. But we've had some close calls. And then there are a few other moments where it's like, seriously, what is happening here? So just want you to know we're with you. And it's not that this physical facility is sacred in and of itself. People are sacred, and we want to care for one another. And we do have some dear members of this congregation who don't have the capacity to dodge your children and figure some of that out. So help us in that regard. All right, now moving on to something that is a little more pastoral. We wanted to let you know that Daniel and Kelly Kaminsky are going to take just a little short sabbatical. We're so thankful for all that Daniel and Kelly do here at Gospel Hope. Daniel is one of our bivocational pastors. We do pay him a small monthly salary is hardly the appropriate word. It's more like just an expression of our gratitude. It's as much as we can do, but it's not a livable wage. And so he actually has a full-time job in addition to being a pastor. And his full-time job as design manager for Craftsman Kitchens has always been demanding for him. But even in recent weeks, a couple of key employees have moved on from that company. And so their work has fallen on Daniel's, and it's sent his already packed load just like into orbit. Probably realistically, as we were talking this week, he said his workload has increased 50 to 75%. Now, the good news is that's short term. The bad news is it's not short enough term. It'll probably be December before the company has help in place. And Daniel, as he was sharing with the other pastor elders, was saying, I'm underwater right now. And we said, well, how can we help? And he said, well, actually, it would be a big help if I could just take maybe 4 Sundays off. And they're not even going to come here, even though we'd want to care for them. And it's not that they're upset with anybody, but you know how it goes. Like, Daniel walks through the door, and you're going to want to say, hey, Daniel, do you know where such and such is? And hey, what about this and that? We really want them to be able to just unplug from Gospel Hope for a few weeks here. Several of us even said, is 4 weeks enough? And he said, it is. So this is something we've decided on together. And we want them to be refreshed and renewed. As he shared, he said, we'll likely visit the family of churches. So Gospel Grace up in the city. He said, we've never been up to Logan to visit Gospel Peace Church. So I don't know what their plans are, but you won't see them around here. To that end, after today's big nursery meeting and some of the other things that'll unfold in the next week, just be respectful of that. And if you have a question related to kids ministry, call one of the other pastors. Or if it's related to nursery, you could call Lizzie Adam. Diane Anger also is expert in that field, and there are others. And I know you'll serve them well. So pray for them. And we're just so thankful for what they contribute and want to help in this particular way. Makes us thankful, too, that there's a plurality of pastor elders here. And we can spread the load. It also is a good reminder that the Good Shepherd never leaves, never takes a sabbatical, never needs one. And so we're thankful for that. In light of that, as we go to prayer here again for just a moment, I do want to invite you to join me in praying for the Cornerstone vote. Cornerstone, some of you are new and wouldn't know what this is about, but we're part of, it's 3 churches right now, Gospel Grace in the heart of Salt Lake, Gospel Peace up in Logan. which is a church plant just a couple of years old, and then Gospel Hope. But there's another church that has a very important congregational vote today where they would accept a ministry plan and also be voting to call Luke Bielsma as their new pastor. And Luke has spoken here. He and his family moved out to Utah about a year ago. And he is currently at Gospel Grace, and they're ready to send him out. It also appears, if the vote goes through, that there may be close to 50 people who leave Gospel Grace to go over and help this this church. Cornerstone's been in the Rose Park area for many, many years, but like many churches, have their ups and downs, and their pastor is approaching retirement, and just saying, we're ready, you know, for a new infusion of life and energy. So we want to remember them in prayer. That vote, I don't know exactly when this morning. I don't think it's already happened, but if not, it's coming close. We're within minutes, if not an hour or so, of all of that. So join me in prayer, not just for God's blessing as we open the Word, but for our dear friends at Cornerstone. Father, thank you for all that you are for us, and give us grace that we may know you, trust in you, just as we were singing. It's hard for us sometimes to fathom that those strands of sorrow and suffering that we endure are part of an actually beautiful and eternal tapestry that you are weaving that will cause us to praise you one day. We live each day with so many unknowns, so much uncertainty in our world, and yet you are the great, unchangeable God, unchangeable in love, unchangeable in purpose, unchanging in grace and mercy for us, even though we sometimes sin knowingly and other times just foolishly and carelessly, but there you remain, continually calling us, summoning us to repent and believe and to obey. Give us grace for all of that. We lift up our dear brothers and sisters at Cornerstone today. They've had many, many months of discussion and planning and preparation. And our desire, Lord, is that your will would be made known today through this vote. We pray that you would unite your people in a renewed commitment to the gospel mission that you have called each of us to. And we ask that it would result not just in a sweet transitional moment for a ministry that you have blessed and used through the decades, but that it would result in a fresh infusion of gospel life in that community, that those who are in spiritual darkness at this moment would see the great light, which is Jesus, that they would have the joy of watching disciples being made from multiple generations, from multiple walks of life and backgrounds, from those who live nearby the church and even some that you might bring from across the valley. Let your will be done. Thank you for all of those who've invested in that process. Would you keep their hearts at rest through this day? And when the final vote is tallied, we ask that it would result in great honor for Christ, great joy for your people, and that it would be a sweet testimony to all that you are doing. Now give us grace as we open your word together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ecclesiastes 7. That's page 556 if you're using one of the Bibles from the seat rack in front of you. We've been in this book now for a number of weeks. We think it was most likely written by Solomon, but I actually read a commentary this week that made a really strong case for not Solomon, and not that I'm, you know, ready to give up on that, but I was like, oh, those are really good thoughts. So it reminded me again that much like the New Testament book of Hebrews, that the author isn't really the important piece. And whether it was Solomon or not, it's still God's truth that we believe he breathed out through the Holy Spirit to give to people like you and me to help us live the life that God has called us to. So today, we come to Ecclesiastes 7. Now, by way of introduction, I actually want to take you back even hundreds of years before this to the story of Job. It's actually one of the oldest stories from the Bible. And Job is quite a hard story to read. You come through it and you say, Lord, what is happening here? Why would this righteous man who has been a faithful husband and faithful father, one that has apparently worked hard and followed your will and served and blessed so many other people through his life. Why would he experience such a great inequity? There's almost a heartlessness that emerges in his deep loss. And if you know the story of Job and just start thinking back through how in one day he lost not only the vast wealth that he had worked hard and God had blessed him with through the years, he lost the resources of cattle and other animal life, and then the news comes in that all 10 of his children are dead in a day. And the calamity of that particular year is deepened by the loss of his health. So that it's not just a matter of, well, let's just pick up and start over, but he doesn't even have the capacity to do that. And as he suffers, his dear wife, who has also lost her 10 children and watched their home, her nest, so to speak, just collapse on itself, she comes to him and in a moment of desperation says, oh, dear Job, curse God and die. And Job doesn't curse God. But in chapter 3, you do read these words where he curses the day of his birth, and he actually says, let the day perish in which I was born, and the night that said, a man is conceived. Let that day be darkness. And you continue reading, and you come to verse 11, and he says, why did I not die at birth? Why did I not come out from the womb and expire? He's wrestling, as many here are wrestling or have wrestled. We all hit those moments where we just say, you know, it might have actually been better if I had not been born. At the end of Ecclesiastes 6, Solomon asked the question, you're already there in chapter 7, so just back up one verse to verse 12, but he asked this question, who knows what is good for man while he lives the few days of his vain life, which he passes like a shadow? Who knows what is good for man? And then the second question, which is equally important, for who can tell man what will be after him under the sun? What's going to happen when you pass away and your children are left behind or a spouse is left behind? What will happen in 100 years if Jesus doesn't return and another generation or two have come after you? And the answer is we don't know what's coming. We don't know what's coming in the next hour. That's part of the reason we turn on the news. Some of you, like, that's almost the first thing you do in the morning. You know, is the world on fire any more than it already has been? I mean, it really is an insane moment, but we don't know, and you'd be a fool to try to predict it. We don't know what will happen in the next hour, let alone what might happen in the world when we lived out our days, and Solomon is wrestling with that. It's knowledge and understanding that is actually hidden from us, and that's actually part of God's wisdom and his goodness, as we're going to see in this passage this morning. So Solomon is actually straining to see the same kinds of things that you and I are. Well, who can tell me what's good about my life? Because it feels like it's all suffering at this moment. And who could possibly make clear what's going to happen after I'm dead and gone? In this passage, he's actually going to help us begin to see some things that really are good. Yes, even when there's suffering and difficulty and confusion and pain. But he also begins to hint at the fact that for the God-fearing soul, because he's begun to lay that truth down, fearing God is what life really is all about, he's going to begin to hint at the fact that the best things are actually in the life to come, not the present day. And he proceeds to answer these two questions that he has laid down here in chapter 6, verse 12, and he begins to answer them with a series of comparisons. So you follow along as I read, and you just begin to note the comparisons, and the little word better is going to be the key to seeing that, and just try to identify how many of them he has and what he's really saying here. So this is the word of the Lord. You follow along as I read Ecclesiastes 7, 1 through 14. A good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for this is the end of all mankind, and the living will lay it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by sadness of face the heart is made glad. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of mirth. It is better for a man to hear the rebuke of the wise than to hear the song of fools. For as the crackling of thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fools. This also is vanity. Surely oppression drives the wise into madness, and a bribe corrupts the heart. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning, and the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. Be not quick in your spirit to become angry, for anger lodges in the heart of fools. Say not, why were the former days better than these? For it is not from wisdom that you ask this. Wisdom is good with an inheritance, an advantage to those who see the sun. For the protection of wisdom is like the protection of money, and the advantage of knowledge is that wisdom preserves the life of him who has it. Consider the work of God. Who can make straight what he has made crooked? In the day of prosperity, be joyful, and in the day of adversity, consider. God has made the one as well as the other, so that man may not find out anything that will be after him. As we've been doing, I'm going to try to summarize these under some broader headings. Some challenging things here, but some rich things. I told you that there's a series of comparisons. I count seven of them specifically. There's one other. I had eight, and then I withdrew that one and said, well, I think it's implied, but I'm going to just stick with seven clear comparisons. Now, what's interesting in these comparisons, it's easy to think that he's saying, well, because this is better than that, that whatever falls into that column is actually a bad thing. But I don't think that is the case. And at least for five of these comparisons, I would actually say the lesser thing is actually a really good thing, and that ends up highlighting the better thing. Did I just confuse you by saying that? Am I talking in riddles? Let me just show you straight out. So look at verse 1 again, and we're going to group several of these comparisons under one larger heading, and here it is. Funerals are better than parties. Some of you are like, wait a minute. No, stick with this, all right? Go back to verse 1. He says, a good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth. Now, precious ointment is actually a good thing. It was both valuable in the ancient Near East, and like any good perfume, it makes the place smell better. There's something to be gained by having precious ointment in the house. And Solomon is establishing for us that a good name is better than this good thing that we know as precious ointment. How about the day of death being better than the day of birth? It would be easy to look at that as a statement of despair, but I don't think that's the only way it can be taken. And we'll fill in more of this thought in the course of the message. But when you begin to lay that comparison next to a couple of other statements that Solomon is making, you begin to understand that he is not saying the day of birth is a bad thing. He's actually saying the day of death is better than the day of birth if you live your life for the right reasons and you live with the right understanding of the God who created you. So funerals remind us, first of all, of the value of life's legacy. It was about 10 years ago that there was a horrific story that came out of Massachusetts where a 14-year-old boy had actually murdered one of his teachers, brutally murdered her. I was struck as I read through that article of just a little line that they had lifted from the funeral service where the pastor who preached that service said of this young teacher that was beloved by so many, he made a poignant statement. Perhaps we should ask not why or even how she died, but rather why and how she lived. That's the point that Solomon's getting at. We all need to be thinking in terms of why am I living and how am I living? You know, like costly perfume spreading its fragrance beyond where it is applied, a good name. A life well lived spreads its influence beyond its duration. That's what makes some of your memories of a loved one or a friend so precious. Even though they've been gone many years, they lived well. They were wise in the way that Solomon is reminding us that we need to be wise. I wonder if you're living that kind of life, living first in the light of God's great truth, living in the reality of his great presence, living for the purposes that he created you for. You know, many people are looking for a great cause to embrace, and some feel the emptiness of their existence even down to the point where they're like, what am I doing with my life? And so they attach themselves to all manner of causes, from saving the planet. You know, when I was a kid, it was save the whales, save the polar bears. Well, now it's the whole planet. So we're terrified that it's going to heat up to a point where we're just going to melt back into the, you know, puddle of premortal goo that we came from, which that's not actually what's going to happen. So we give ourselves to this cause and that cause, and yet many people miss the great cause that God has created them for, because the great cause, the single greatest thing you can live for, is to know the God who created you and to love him in response to how he's loved you. Then the secondary cause that flows out of that, and it is as important and great according to Jesus, is you love others. But a lot of people want to bypass the first great purpose that they were created for, to know God and love him. That actually would be a wasted life. Be great loss. As Jesus says, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and yet lose his soul? No, funerals remind us of the value of life's legacy. Here's a second thought. If you go to verse 2 and beyond, funerals remind us of death's finality. You see, it's actually good to attend funerals and think about the end of your life, because we're all going to end up there. Solomon writes, this is the end of all mankind, and the living lay it to heart. Then he says, sorrow is better than laughter, for by sadness of face the heart is made glad. You see, the sadness you experience while mourning the death of a relative or friend should result in a wise assessment of, well, how am I living? And when my time comes, what will I be remembered for? One of the unique experiences, even privileges, I would say it's a true privilege of pastoral ministry, is you get to spend time with funeral directors. The church I came from in South Carolina was significantly larger than Gospel Hope, that consequently we have more funerals. And you get to know some of the directors well enough when you're in a place long enough. And one of the directors that I really enjoyed spending time with was named Jerry. Jerry had an interesting story. I even said one day, we were riding out to a cemetery for a committal service, and I said, Jerry, I got to ask you, how did you end up in this? Because, you know, frankly, it just seems odd that you want to live your life and spend your days helping people plan funerals and then overseeing these things. And he began to actually, it surprised me, the story that he told was he grew up way out in the country, and his grandmother was the woman in the community that people called when they had a loved one died, and she came in and helped prepare the body and made all the arrangements for the wake, as they called it, in that particular area. And he said, I saw the ministry that my grandmother had with people in one of the hardest moments of their lives, and I thought, you know, if God would let me, I want to give my life to that kind of ministry and service. And I thought that was beautiful. But Jerry could tell some great stories. And on another occasion, I said, what are some of the funniest things that have ever happened to you? And you know, funeral directors do have a sense of humor. You sometimes have to dig for it a little bit. But Jerry goes, and he's Southern too, and I won't do his accent justice, but just in your mind's ear, just imagine a thick Southern accent as Jerry began to tell me, oh, Pastor Danny, there's a funeral that I directed one time, and it was a long service, almost 3 hours, wailing and weeping and carrying on. And when we finished the service and we began to proceed out of the church and down the front steps and the pallbearers on either side of the casket in a sweet and Southern, you know, gentlemanly way, he said, and this was a large woman. He said, but as we made it down the front steps, the bottom of the casket turned loose. And listen to this description. And the deceased fell to the ground. The deceased. And he said, and then you should have heard the carrying on and wailing that commenced. And I said, Jerry, what did you do? He goes, well, what can you do? You've got to put things back together and, you know, go on with this thing. Oh, Jerry could tell some amazing stories and entertain for hour after hour. Now, I don't share that to make light of funerals at all. It's a tender time. And I've been through enough of them and know the weight and sorrow that we all experience. But you know, funerals remind us that death is coming for all of us. It's unavoidable. You've only got so many days on planet Earth. You only have so many holidays to enjoy with your family and friends. And honestly, you don't have enough to squander them in petty squabbles or ruin them with stubborn demands of family and friends. How many times have you gone, and maybe some of you have even said it personally, but you've attended a visitation or a wake or a funeral, and you've heard somebody express deep regret that there was a family fracture that was never mended? That's an added sorrow when you weep because you've wasted precious time. Look at verse 4. Solomon says, "The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning." Wise people are always thinking, my funeral's coming. Now, sometimes at a point like this, you might say, well, that's just kind of morbid. No, it's actually wisdom. Occasionally through the years, I've even heard people say, I don't do funerals. Well, you should. Because God says the wise keep a piece of their heart in the funeral parlor. One of my favorite authors, commentators, has written that to be in the presence of sickness or death has a tendency to bring us quickly to the really crucial issues of life. It's better to go to a funeral than a party. Let's press on. Look at verse 5. I'm going to group a few other things together. Rebuke is better than entertainment. Solomon begins to talk about how a wise man will rebuke a person that he loves, and that this actually becomes a gift. It's better for a man to hear the rebuke of the wise than to hear the song of fools. A rebuke is simply a correction, and it may include a warning. It may include, you know, some kind of caution in advance, or it may include correction of something that has already transpired. Solomon wrote in Proverbs 13:1, "A wise son hears his father's instruction, but a scoffer does not listen to rebuke." What's a scoffer? Well, that's a person who would even receive some kind of rebuke or correction or instruction, but who turns it into a joke. Would actually jeer the person or mock the person who has come, but treats the other person and the message with contempt. You don't want to be a scoffer. Scoffers are often cut off suddenly without remedy. They are akin to the fools that Proverbs also lists. Passages like Proverbs 17:10 tell us that a rebuke goes deeper into a man of understanding than 100 blows into a fool. A wise man unveils the realities of life. Oh, that takes me back. That's like the phone that sat on the kitchen counter that was plugged into the wall, you know, that had a cord on it that you could stretch maybe 15 feet. Some of you grew up with the phones like that, all right? That's what it sounded like. Thank you for taking me back. A foolish friend, though. So, I'm falling behind here. So a wise man will unveil reality. That's what the rebuke is all about. He sees or hears or observes something that needs to be addressed in your life. What a gift that is when somebody comes to you and says, "Brother, I love you." Or as a parent says, "Child of mine, please listen." That's a gift. It's the fool, though, who masks the realities of life. Look at how Solomon describes this. The heart of fools, he says at the end of verse 4, is in the house of mirth. That is, he only thinks about the next extravagant party. And then he goes on to describe the song of fools in verse 5. Well, you say, what is a song of a fool? Well, it's a song that has no substance to it. It's not inherently immoral, could be. That's not absolutely necessary, but as one author writes, the song of fools is, if not immoral, yet morally and spiritually hollow. senseless, unbridled madness. And so the fool who entertains his own heart with vain and empty things also becomes a diversion and distraction to his friend. He's masking reality. There are actually more important things that need to be dealt with. And his heart is entertained by those things lacking long-term significance. That's the point of verse 6 and the little illustration of crackling of thorns under a pot. Those of you who've camped and built a fire know that you can light a fire, you know, with dried out pine needles and get a quick flame, but you're not going to cook over pine needles. You need wood that has some substance, and if you're, you know, going to cook a big meal, you need to find, a really good thing is to find seasoned hardwood. Get that good bed of coals, you can put baked potatoes on there, and you're not like continually throwing pine needles in there. Well, that's kind of the image here. There's just no substance in it. So rebuke is better than trivial entertainment that will temporarily hide the real issues. Rebuke is better than entertainment. Let's press on here. The long view is better than a short view. Look at verses 8, 9, and 10. This is a great portion. Look at verse 8, first of all. Wisdom patiently waits for God to write the good ending of our story. You say, where do you get that? Well, hold with me, and I think we'll build a little bit of a case for this. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning. Then Solomon is going to talk about the patient in spirit versus the proud in spirit. Then in verse 9, he's going to say, be not quick in your spirit to become angry. Anger lodges in the heart of fools. And then verse 10, say not, why were the former days better than these? It is not from wisdom that you ask this. Now, real important question here, even before we go much deeper, is, well, who are we asking these questions to? Or who are we asking these questions of? And I think what's clearly implied is God. God's at the heart of this, and so this is actually a bit of a conversation and dialogue with God who oversees all of this. Now, back up to verse 8, and I want you to think through this with me for just a moment. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning. Have you ever watched a movie with someone who isn't patient enough to let the story play out and see how it will end? And whether you've seen it before or not, it's more frustrating when you haven't seen it either, and yet, you know, your friend or family member, whoever is there, going like, well, why did he say that? What? She's going to do that right now? What? Like, what's that about? Do you know how the story ends? And like, there's this barrage of unending questions, and after a while, you're like, can you shut up and let the story play out? I did not pay $12 to sit here and listen to you, you know, ask a series of questions that I don't know the answers to. And can I just say before some of you fill in the blank, I'm not like preaching a, you know, passive aggressive sermon at my wife at this moment, right? Truly. Now, she does ask more questions in life than I do, but I don't mind watching a movie with her. So don't assign that to her or to me right now. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning. And it's the patient in spirit that are commended here. You see, these are the ones who've learned to wait for the full story to unfold. It's the proud in spirit who think that they know a better way for the story to be written, or actually get angry that it's not being written the way that they want it to. And I want you to think with me for a moment of some of the stories in the Bible, how many of them transpire over years and decades, and very often the people in these stories have to wait for God's full work to unfold and be accomplished before they actually experience the good. It was 25 years between the time God gave Abraham and Sarah the promise, not just of a son, but said, your descendants will be more than the stars of the heaven or the sand of the sea. And yet for 24 years, you know, 11 months and, you know, however many days it was, they didn't have one child. God, what are you doing? We thought we were going to have a family that could, you know, be numbered like the stars of heaven. And God's saying, wait, I'm writing the story. Joseph had to endure 13 years of great suffering and injustice before, in a moment, God exalted him to great power and influence to the salvation of his entire family. Hannah was childless for many years before Samuel was born. Zechariah and Elizabeth were childless into their old age before God gave them John, the greatest prophet, second only to Christ in his age. Anna was a widow for many years, the scriptures tell us, serving in obscurity in the temple with fasting and prayer. She was 84 years old when she finally saw the Christ child. The woman with the issue of blood suffered for 12 years, spending all of her financial resources for a cure that no one could give her until Jesus arrived. Wisdom looks at the stories that God writes and begins to understand that the end is better than the beginning. And wisdom learns to wait patiently for God to write these beautiful endings in all our stories. Look at verse 9. Be not quick in your spirit to become angry. Well, here's a second thought. Wisdom guards against anger with God while we're in the middle of the story. And that's the point that Job was at. I cursed the day I was born. Had I known that I would be here at this moment, it would have been better for me not to be born. But he's in the middle of the story, and he doesn't know what's going to happen yet. He just knows that it's a crushing weight that he has to bear at the moment. And you know, it's understandable that we find ourselves angry when life is not going the way we think it should, when circumstances are far beyond our control or understanding. But the Lord warns us, don't be quick in your spirit to become angry. Anger lodges in the heart of fools. Look at verse 10. Wisdom, this is really helpful, but wisdom refuses what I want to describe as nostalgic discontentment with God while living through the hard circumstances of the story. Solomon says simply, say not, why were the former days better than these? It's not from wisdom that you ask this. He's not actually contending with the fact that the former days were better. Some of you can look back and say, those were better days than now. This is harder than it was then. This is more difficult or confusing or perplexing than then. Yep, but don't ask that from a place of nostalgic discontentment. It's more than just reminiscing about the good old days. There's a place for that. And the older you get, the more you tend to do that, right? What we have to guard against is a discontentment against God that says that in its own way, God, I don't like you for moving me out of a good season of life or good days and bringing me to this point. The warning is, it's not from wisdom that you ask God why it was better then than it is now. And the reason we don't ask that is because when you're living even through the hard circumstances, you haven't gone to the end. If you could interview some of the people, some of the saints that I just mentioned, from Abraham and Sarah, you know, through Joseph and Hannah, do you think they would write a different story than what God wrote? I don't think so. But do you think it was really, really hard? Well, we know it was. Dig a little deeper into the Abraham-Sarah story where they're trying to figure this thing out on their own, and man, what chaos they create, and how many times did, you know, Abraham, you know, like hide behind his wife and say, you know, tell this guy that you're my sister because I don't want to die. I mean, their marriage was in pretty rough shape at least three or four different times in all of that. And yet I submit to you that because of where God did bring them in this life, and certainly now in eternity, there's not one thing they would change other than maybe saying, well, if I could live it over again, I wouldn't sin in the way I did. Guard your heart against a discontentment with God, even though there are hard circumstances. Now that brings us to the last little portion. Go to verse 11, and I want us to spend these last few minutes looking at the wisdom and work of God. I'm not going to spend any time in verses 11 and 12, but Solomon says simply, God's wisdom adds advantage to life. And you can just dig in a little deeper and study that. What I really want to go to is verses 13 and 14 and just kind of like wrap all of this up, because I think there's some really marvelous truth. God's work, if as you begin to consider it, is often mysterious. A technical word is inscrutable. That means you really can't know it fully, understand it completely. But God may be fully trusted. Fully trusted. Now look at Solomon's instruction here. First in verse 13, consider the work of God. That is, you need to look at this seriously and come to a conclusion. Consider God's work with a view that we want to come out with a right conclusion or make a right judgment about the work of God. And then he asks this question, who can make straight what he has made crooked? Well, it's clearly implying that nobody can make something straight when God makes it crooked. And that's true. That's because God is sovereign. And he does what he knows is best, and he does what he determines is best. But the crooked things of life are the very points that you and I struggle with so intensely. The crooked things are the things in life that we wish could be very different, things that we've even looked at in this passage, like death and sorrow and mourning. Those are crooked moments. And sometimes they are so crooked, they're life-altering. And you say, my life will never be the same. You're right. But similar to the stories of those who had to wait for the good end of their stories to come, so there are many stories of people's lives who were made crooked. Listen to me. We try to defend God's sovereignty in some moments. Our hearts are in the right place, but we're actually making a mess of it when we act like, well, God had nothing to do with it. For instance, even in our situation, we haven't heard this much, but there have been a few people who've seemed to, you know, indicate, well, you know, Kristen's cancer is not from God. When we read through a passage like this where you see it being just plainly stated, verse 14, in the day of prosperity, be joyful, in the day of adversity, consider God has made the one as well as the other. If we can't trust God even with the hard circumstances of life, then why would we trust him? It would drive me to insanity to think that God actually had nothing to do with this dread moment. But if he actually is overseeing it and superintending it, then I can draw a breath even when we're confused or uncertain or fearful to say, God, your ways are mysterious and unknown to us, but we can trust you. Now, I made a statement that there are people in the scriptures whose lives are made crooked by God for a greater purpose. There may be no clearer example of this than in John 9, if you want to turn there very quickly, but I'm only going to summarize some things. But this is the powerful story where the disciples are with Jesus and they encounter a man who is blind from birth. He didn't lose his healthy vision. He didn't suffer an accident that took his vision. He wasn't born with the capacity to see. And the disciples asked Jesus a really important question. Who sinned, the man or his parents? Isn't that the way we typically think? Oh, bad stuff happens to you. You must have done something. Well, Jesus has a remarkable answer in John 9, verse 3. He says, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. Really? Yeah. And the specific work of God that was about to be displayed, if you read through the story, was what this may not be original with me, but I don't know who I'd attribute it to, but this is the term that was coming to my mind over the last couple of days, a micro-creation. Like, this is one of the greatest miracles. They're all fabulous, but to me, this is astonishing because if you study the human eye, you know that I think there are like over 30 muscles, and then there are electrical systems that are tied in there, and photoreceptors and special cells that God has created, you know, to receive light through them. And then you're so marvelously created by God that your body is designed to translate those things into electrical impulses that go back to your brain, so that as you open your eyes and you're seeing in 3D vision, maybe that's not the most accurate way, but he didn't just put one amazing eyeball in your head, he put two eyeballs in your head, and you can see and perceive color and depth and all these marvelous things. This guy wasn't born with that capacity, but in this moment, Jesus creates. It's more than a healing. He creates the capacity to see. And the man who was born blind can see. And then a big debate and discussion erupts, and the religious leaders call him in and want to know, who healed you? And like there's some big game, some big deception underway, and they call his parents in, and nobody really is satisfied with a simple answer. And the man just says at one point, all I know is that before I was blind, now I see. End of story. But Jesus gives us an even bigger perspective on this than just a marvelous moment for a blind man. Jesus, the creator of the universe, acts in a way and tells us straight up, this actually was done that the works of God might be displayed in him. It's terrifying. And we can roll through a series of questions and say, well, how is that fair? How is it fair that God had this man live into his adult years a blind man? Think of all that he suffered. Think of all that he endured. Think of the struggle that his parents had to care for him in his childhood and then his teenage years and all of the pressure that they lived under. Yeah. It's mysterious. Would the blind man rewrite his story? We could talk about Paul's thorn in the flesh that the Lord never removed. These are crooked paths. But you know, as I was thinking on this over the last couple of days, there is no path that was made more crooked by the sovereign hand of God than the path Jesus Christ walked. The path of his incarnation, winding its way through the sin and shame of the world he created, the disease and death that were the result of his image bearer's rebellion against him. And even our men's meetup on Friday is going through the Gospel of John, and we were just looking this past Friday again, or two Fridays ago, actually, I think it was, but just the astonishing thing that when Jesus came into the world, his own creation did not recognize him or receive him. And yet there's Jesus walking the crooked path that his Father and the Spirit and he had decided. And Isaiah captures the crooked nature of this path so beautifully when he writes of Christ, he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him and no beauty that we should desire him. I mean, wouldn't you think God the Father would send his Son into the world, you know, not just in a flash of glory, but like make him the most beautiful man on planet Earth and make him like the perfect physical specimen so that people would go, look at this God. But apparently he didn't. He was so ordinary that you and I would walk right past him with no thought that this was God come from heaven. He's not only so ordinary and that he's easily overlooked. Isaiah goes on to write in verse 3, he was actually despised and rejected by men and a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Didn't even give him the time of day. Surely he has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him that as we judged him to have been stricken and smitten by God and afflicted. The what's implied here is that we just assumed, well, you die a terrible death like that on the cross, clearly you've done something wrong. We were kind of back to where the disciples were. Who sinned, this man or his parents? For Jesus to be put on the cross, what sin did he do? Or certainly it must have been his parents. But that's where, amazingly, this crooked road continues. as Isaiah says, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The discipline that brought us peace was placed on him. And in those terrible wounds, we were healed. Oh, the crooked path that led Jesus to the cross. What no one else could see, not even the disciples who were closest to him, who heard him predict multiple times what was about to happen, is that the crooked path that led to the cross and into a tomb on Friday would also take a glorious turn and straighten out on Sunday as he rose from the dead. The signal that the guilt of our sins was removed forever. The clear indicator that the debt of our sins had been paid in full, and that the most horrific consequence of sin, death itself, lay dead in the grave, and life would forever be ours. Yeah, he's sovereign over all of our days. He is sovereign over every crooked path. And if you look at verse 14, it becomes even sweeter to think that we should be joyful in our prosperity, we should be thoughtful in adversity, and yes, Solomon could only glimpse some things that I think we see in more radiant light, and though you and I can't fully understand all that God is doing, that's the final point, that man may not find out anything that will be after him. You and I don't know the future, but God does. So here's the great consolation. And you stand at the foot of the cross and you begin to survey the stories of the saints who came before all of that. And we know some stories of saints who have followed since then. And in every single one of them, the crooked paths that led them through suffering and led them through hardship, where they were tempted to question the goodness of God, where they were tempted to be angry that the circumstances didn't unfold the way they should, all of that eventually gave way to glory. And that's the promise for you and me. How amazing. The cross of Jesus Christ is the definitive answer. I know that some of you are in harder places than you ever fathomed you would be, and it's not easy. And the last thing you need is some kind of little, you know, spiritual Hallmark card to show up in the mail, you know, where, oh, just trust Jesus and life will be good. You know, you can trust Jesus and actually die a martyr. But what we do need to be reminded of, and I'm going to Romans 8, is that because Jesus walked the ultimate crooked road, all of us can be confident that even the crooked places we're experiencing right now are leading to a glorious end. Paul has the audacity to say that all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. You think it's killing you? It's actually making you more like Jesus. You were predestined to be conformed to the image of his son in order that he, Jesus, might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. You see the unbreakable chain of your salvation? Verse 31, what then shall we say to these things, to the crooked places, to the crooked things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him freely, graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It's God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall crooked things like tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We're regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation who will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's the God we serve. That's the God who orders your days, knows the end from the beginning, and who has taken you as his own. So in the middle of all this crooked, broken, confusing, maddening, global insanity, trust him and press on in faith. He really does secure you to the very end. Would you bow your heads with me, please? Are you trusting him? Are you living in the security of the fear of God? For some of you, God feels like the greatest threat to your existence. It's actually the greatest security you will ever know. Will you yield to him today? Will you confess that you're sinful, deserving of condemnation, but come to him and say, please forgive me. Give to me the gift of eternal life. Heal my soul of my spiritual blindness. Heal my heart of the anger and bitterness. God, I give it to you. Give my life to you. Will you do that today? Father, you know every heart. And though your ways and works are mysterious and inscrutable, we are not mysterious, unknowable to you. Would you strengthen those whose hearts are weak and weary? The crooked circumstances they live with are overwhelming. Show them today that your grace is greater. And for that one who continues to wrestle for autonomy and independence, gently break them of that and lead them sweetly and safely to the Savior who died and rose again. We need you, God. We need your wisdom for life, and we need your works to be made evident to us in this life. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name, amen. Several of us remain available after the service, and if you'd like to have a word of prayer together or some follow-up discussion, that would be a great joy for us. And I'm gonna be here at the front. Others will be scattered throughout the building. Some of you came at the invitation of a friend or family member, and I know they would love to talk with you more about God's word that we're studying together. Let us know how we can serve you in any way. Well, we're gonna sing once again, as we always do, and we sing in response to God's word, so we're gonna go back to one of the hymns that we sang earlier. Let's stand together and join our voices and our hearts in praise to this sovereign God.